Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to Midas e-learning session. My name is Puya Banibayat. I'm in charge of technical support and training team at the New York office of Midasoft. And today I'm going to show you some modeling and analysis skills with Midas Civil for modeling and analysis of network height arches. So some of you guys attended the first and the second course of the e-learning sessions, and as you know, this is this training is the third course of our new technical series called e-learning courses. So in the February session series, which started by a presentation from Dr. Gregor Wallman of HNTV, he presented a network tight arch bridges, and then the session followed by an in-depth discussion and case study about that type of bridge, which was last week. So in the first session, Dr. Wallman shared his years of experience in design of the network tight arch bridges. And then in the second course, I explained analysis and design considerations for that type of bridge. And today we are going to learn how to create finite element modeling of a network tight arch bridges, and how to run different set up and run different type of analysis. So in today's session, we're gonna have three parts. First part is introduction and having a flashback to the last session, talking about the project that we're going to model today. Then it will be the modeling part, which we define the material sections, generating the geometry, and finally we apply the boundary conditions and loads. And then the third part will be analysis and design. So we talk about the moving load analysis, final stage analysis, which we're going to use some of the functions like unknown load factors and hanger force tuning. Then we have the we will show you how to set up the construction stages and how to perform the construction stage analysis. And if we get time, we're going to time history analysis for hanger losses. Okay, so the first part of the introduction, we start with the summary of in-depth discussion what happened in the last session to just knowing this flow. And then talking about the Midas graphical user interface for whom are not familiar with the software, and then talking about the project introduction. Okay. So last session, we talked about the design and construction of the network tight arches, and whatever we have to consider. Whatever we have to consider during the, for the design of this type of bridges. So as a summary, we came up with two analysis, two important analysis, one which would be final stage analysis, another one is construction stage, which if you remember, we said that in the final stage, we have a kind of linear behavior in the material and in the elements. While in the construction stage, we are seeing nonlinear behaviors, like we are seeing that sagging in the cables and material. If you are using a concrete, the concrete is not set, and it's, we have to use those nonlinear behavior. So for each of these stages, we introduced some functions in Midas Civil which can help you to complete that analysis at that stage. So for the final stage, we talked about the unknown load factors, which help you to find the forces, required forces in each hanger or each cables to come up with the final geometry which, with the certain tolerance. Then talked about the cable tuning to show how we can adjust those forces that the software gave us to come up with the a limitation for a bending moment or displacement or anything which is needed for you, is important for your design. Then we talked about the time history analysis and showing how to set up a time history analysis to model the hangar loss, which is a pretty critical issue for structures which are based on the cables or hangars. Then for the construction stage analysis, we talked about the how to model the nonlinear material, how we can set up those, see those effects, time-dependent effects, if we have composite section, how to model them, and also, more importantly, about the lack of feed force, which during the construction of this type of bridges, which, having the hangers or cable elements, it's pretty important to know how much force we have to apply in each stage. Then the final stage, or when the bridge is constructed completely, we are having the correct geometry. Okay, so today I'm going to have the modeling, create two models for you, one for final stage and one for construction stages. Okay, so this is a general graphical user interface of Midas Civil, for whom are not familiar with. So just quickly showing some part of that. Here in top we have the main menu, which under each icon we have, under each ribbon we have lumped so many other options, which just make it so easy for the user to find whatever they want. For example, if you want to model the structure, so you have to go to the structure tab, or if you want to create a node and element or do any changes on those, so you have to go to the node and element. So it just make it very intuitive to for the user to just learn the software pretty fast and follow the modeling pretty quickly. Then we have the tree menu. Under tree menu, as some of you know, whatever we model, whatever we define, it will be shown up here. It could be sections, material, the geometries, type of element that we use, loads, boundaries, everything that you define, we can see them under tree menu. And that helped the user a lot to understand and see everything in one shot to see what is modeled and what is required to be modeled. Or if they want to change anything, that will be very fast to do any changes. So you can, for example, if you want to change a section, you can simply drag and drop it on the page, on the main menu, modeling view, and it will be changed instantly. The message window shows up at the bottom of the this page, and that's the way that software communicates with the user. So while you are doing the modeling, if you do anything wrong, some elements and then the analysis are not compatible with each other, or you have some duplication, software comes up with some message, warning message or error messages, then let you know that what did you do wrong and then how to fix it. So that's pretty helpful. Instead of sometimes you need to just check 100 things to understand what did you do wrong. So that message window helped a lot in terms of modeling and overcoming the problems. You see a rendering view. You see how nice renders you can get from the Midas Civil. And we have the main model view. As you see, you can divide the model views. You can have a couple of the windows at the same time, or you could have windows and then the tables at the same time, as you see we are seeing here. So you can have two tables or like couple of tables and windows at the same time showing the results and then the modeling for the comparison. Okay, so we're gonna go through the software and you will get more familiar to that. And what we are going to model today is a network tight arch, and the span is 300 feet with a height 60 feet and with the width of 30 feet. So totally we are using a 30 hangers at each site, and as you see there, this is the hangar arrangement. All right, so we're gonna model also two lanes of traffic. and running the moving load analysis on them. Okay, so I open the Midas and start modeling. So this is the general, the model that we're going to create. Excuse me. And you see how it's done. Okay. By the way, we're going to share this video recording and also the presentation. So later on, if you want to go through that and do it yourself, you have the references to follow. By the way, if you have any questions, please feel free to send your questions to the question option. All right. So as you see, we have these tabs starting from view, structure, node and element, properties, boundaries. So this setup in these icons are set up in a way to start from left and then finish in the right. So structure, you see, you can just model the beams and column and you know, using these wizards. And if you're doing any other type of structure like an arch or the, anything, you can just simply use these wizards. Then it will be node and element if you want to create your structure from scratch, which this is what we're going to do today. Then we're going to be property, material, and the sections, then boundary, then loads, and then analysis. So the flow is starting from left and then ends to the right. Okay, so as I say, I'm going to start from scratch and generate my geometry step by step. You see how this is done. Just to save time, I can show you how we can create the material and section for one of them, and then later on I'm gonna just open a new model file. I'm gonna borrow the material and sections from other model file that I have just to save time. Okay, so to define a material, you can go to the property tab and then click on the material property. A new dialog box opens for you. And then by clicking add, you have options. You can define the steel, concrete, steel reinforced concrete, or any user defined material. Now I select steel. And then selecting just steel 09, and from them I am just defining one of the options from the database of ASTM. But you know, you have these options here. You can select from any of the codes, and also you can define your own user defined. If you want to change anything in this, you can simply do the changes to the steel. So okay, and then the material is selected. So if I go to the section tab, I can also define the sections. But to save time, if you already defined the sections and material in other model, you can simply import them. So if I click import, so I can go with the construction stage option. And these are five sections that I already defined in the other model. And I can say okay, and then the sections will come to this part. So you can just click on them one by one and see their shape. Close. Okay. So just please take care of that. This is whenever, whatever we model, you're going to see them under the tree menu. So as we go, this will grow up. All right. So let's go back to the node and element. So what I'm trying to do first, I'm defining one of the arches with the one side of the arch. Then create the hangers. When it's completed, we're gonna just copy that arch to the other side and then connect them together. All right. Let's see how it's done. So click on the create node. I'm going to create three nodes. One is 00. Let me set it up to hips and feet because my dimensions are based on feet. So 00, then the other one will be 300 in X direction, and then Y and Z are 0 because my total length was 300. Apply. And then to create my arch, I'm going to create another node in coordinate 150, 0, and 60. So this is exactly based on the geometry. So if I click on that, I see three nodes. So if I go to the front view, I see such option. So I need to create one more node, which will be at negative 75, 0, and negative 300. I'll tell you why do I need this later. Okay. Close. And now I want to create the create my structure. So this will be my total span or tie. So if I go click on the create element and select a material, we have only one material. We're going to use one material for entire structure. But definitely you can, I mean, this is for simplicity, but definitely you can assign different material to different part of the structure. And I'm selecting a tie and creating the node, creating an element from here to here. So it's only one piece element. Then I'm going to create my arch, and for doing that, I can click on the create line element on curve. So arch by 3 points. And I want to divide it into 16 pieces, or so P1 will be this point, P2 this point, and P3. So this is assigned. So as you see, I already selected the section as an arch. And if I go here, you see that this is created. So still, we are in the 2D. Now I'm going to create the hangers. So the hangers, for creating the hangers, I created a one node in the far distance. So I'm gonna just one by one apply to this to come up with the you know, the configuration of my hangers. So again, go back to the create element. This time for creating the hangers, I'm going to use a truss element. Now for the arch and for the tie, I use the general beam element. Now I'm going to change it to the truss. We can use tension only, but because, as I said, we're going to model, create two models. In the first model, which is for final stage, we have nonlinear behavior, linear behavior. So all the tension only or cables will transfer to a truss element. So that's better to use a truss element from now. So the cable elements are working only in the when we are doing the nonlinear analysis, because other than that it would be like a normal truss. Okay, so I just change my section to cable and connecting the node from here to here. By the way, we have two options here called intersect. So if you check them, means whenever the element is intersecting any node or any other element, will break down to, you know, that many pieces. So for example, here when this intersecting this tie, it breaks it down. So I want to do that. So definitely I'm gonna keep this checked right here. So we do it one by one. So totally we have 15 of them, and as you see, the angles will change from left to right. So now as go as far as we go to the right side, we're gonna see lesser degrees. So there are so many other ways to create such a hangers, but I prefer to do that. I feel more comfortable with this method. So but you can select any other methods as well. Alright, so now I need to delete this element because we don't need them at all. So let me just select these and hit delete, and it's deleted. Alright, so I have my half of the hangers are created. So let's close that. Now we have option called mirror, as you see here. So I can simply mirror this option. So let me this hangers. Select entire hangers and use a mirror, as it it asked me in the XYZ plane. So I want to go with the 150, because 150 will be our mid span. So this is, I'm selecting 150 feet, do no changes, and you know, I'm not checking in the intersect, because if I check the intersect, whenever the hangers are intersecting each other, it's gonna break it down and create a new node. But this is not what's happening in real life, because each hanger is working completely separate from others. So I'm check them off and apply. All right, this created. Now there is one thing we have to consider here. If I zoom in, you see these hangers that I used that mirror option. This is showing a one node here, but actually there is no break in the node. For example, if I turn this down, you see this element here, it starts from here and ends here. So it means the ith end is here, j end is here. So there is no intersection between this hanger and this element. So it means they are not intersecting each other. But the hanger cannot stay on the air, so definitely it has to be connected. So to ensure that this connection happening, we have to use the intersect. So we use the intersect option and select only this part of the structure, the tie, and apply. So if I zoom in now, you see that this part, which was continuous, now it break it down into two small pieces. If you don't do that, actually you come up with some singularity error, because the hangers is on the air, there is no support and there is no connection to the structure. Okay. All right, one part of the structure is created. Now what we can do, we can just start rotating it because it has a 10 degree angle. If I go to the side view, so these options right here are the view options. So if you go, you can go with like isometric, see the 3D view, you can see from the top, you can see from the side, or you can see from the front. Now we're gonna go to the side because I'm going to rotate it 10 degrees and then you see how it's rotated. So for rotating this structure, you have two options. One is to rotate the beam nodes, another one is to rotate the elements. If you rotate the elements, actually the nodes remain here. So I don't like that, then I'm gonna delete those. So to prevent that one, we're gonna rotate the nodes. Click rotate. And by this clicking on this option, entire the structure will be selected. We're gonna move it, we don't wanna copy, and the angle of rotation will be negative 10 degree because we're going a counterclockwise or clockwise if you take this x and y. Alright, and then about and 2 points. So we can go with the x, y, or z, but I wanna go with the two points because I wanna exactly rotate it about this x-axis or the tie. So I can select it, first point and then the last point. I think I selected it wrong. Yeah, because the first point going to be the point of origin and the other one would be the other end, and apply. Alright, if I go to the side view now, you see that it's actually angled and 10 degree rotated. So this is exactly what we are looking for. Okay. So if you hold the control key and then the wheel mouse button, the middle click on your mouse, so you can just simply rotate them 360 and see the different angles. All right. So this part is also done. Now the next part is to copy this to the other side. To do that, I just simply select entire thing by clicking on this, it will be select entire thing, and again we're going to use the mirror because now we're going to mirror it exactly about the x-axis with the 15 feet away from the point of origin. So this time we're gonna go to z-x-plane. Why? Because this is, if you look at this, this is the x-axis, this is the y-axis, and this is z-axis will be perpendicular to those. So we're going to stay in the z x-axis and then copy it for the about the y is equal to 15 feet because the total width of the structure was 30, so I'm selecting a half of that. And this time we're going to copy that because we need the structure to have in both sides and apply. All right, you see that structure is created on the other hand as other side as well. Okay, now is the time to generate the cross beams and longitudinal girders. Okay, so to make it easy, let me just deactivate this part because I'm going to work on the tie. So we can select the top part and deactivate them. And now we have only the ties. So it just makes it easier for me to generate those. But if you want to see them, you can also activate them. All right, so I want to show you a couple of the functions on Midas Civil. One of the functions is extrude. So extrude means if you have a node, you can create a higher dimension element. For example, if you have a node, you can create a line element. If you have a line, you can create a 2D or plate element. And from 2D, you can create a 3D. Now, I want to select a couple of the nodes and then extrude them and create a line element. So I want to select a tie for the section, and then let me select my nodes. Will be one here, one on the other hand, other end, one here. I'm gonna go symmetric. Okay, this is another one. And finally, we're going to have this option. All right, so we selected seven nodes, and I'm going to give them because we're going to extrude them in the Y direction. So I say in the Y direction, go five times and multiply it six times because total width of the structure is 30 feet. And apply, so you see that these cross frames or cross beams are generated. All right, now is the time to generate the longitudinal elements. Let me go to the side and select the top and then deactivate them. All right, so if I go to the top, I want to create some longitudinal members. So again, I can go to the create element. This is another technique for creating the elements. One was extrude. This one, I want to be direct generation. So I'm going to just show you this one again. So I select the girder for the section. And nodal connectivity, I ensure that this is set on the general beam. Click on the nodal connectivity from this end to that end, and this time just ensure that the intersect is connected because definitely the longitudinal girder should have connection and intersection with the cross beams. Otherwise, they don't work together. It will be completely separate elements, and this is not what we're looking for. All right, so I created five longitudinal members and close. All right, everything looks good so far. One more thing. So now I want to activate the entire thing, clicking on this option, activate all. So let's see what are we missing. Okay, the bracing should be placed now. To generate the bracing, let me just, you know, deactivate the rest of the structure. To do that, we can just simply select these guys and then inactivate them. That's one option. But there is also a simpler option. If you come to the tree menu and double click on the arch, it shows you this arch is selected to these elements. Then I can select these by double clicking on that and then say activate. Everything is gone and we are just seeing these guys. So let me go to the top view and start creating these hangers, the bracing. Just ensure that this on the beam element, general beam element, selecting the braces and start creating them. So from here to here, here to this, this to this. So here again, I can use that mirror option. That's, you know, because anywhere that you have that symmetric geometry, you can simply use that mirror. And, you know, that just make it shorter for you to do the modeling. But here I don't have that much of element. It's like a couple of them. So I prefer to do it manually. But if you have a large number of the elements, definitely that option help you a lot. And finally, the last pieces. Yes, it looks good now. Let me just save this model. Okay. All right. So this part is done. Almost the structure is completed. So okay, we're done with the modeling of the geometry. So we have a 300 feet long bridge with the 60 feet height and then the 30 feet width. All right, so let's generate these loads and then apply them to the structure and also create the boundaries. So before that, let me do quickly create some groups. Groups are actually used for construction stage analysis and also for moving load analysis. So by group, it means, for example, groups, we have structure, boundary, and load. For example, for the structure group, it means you are selecting a couple of the nodes and elements and then assign them to the certain group, and then later on in the construction stages, instead of activating or, you know, constructing each element, you're activating a group of elements. So that make it easier and makes more sense. So to do that, let me just define some of these groups for you. So for the structure group, I'm gonna have deck stage. So in this stage, we are not using these guys for the final stage because the model that I'm creating is for the final stage. But I'm just creating that because for the next model, we're gonna use the same model, and definitely there we need them. All right, so let me just name it. So deck stage from 1 to 4. So if you give this suffix, it's gonna create them all in one shot. Then we're gonna have arch stage from 1 to 5 at, and then we have the hangers start from 1 to 30. If you remember, we said that we have 30 hangers at each side, and at. All right, so these groups are created. I want to add a couple more, like a cross beams, because for the modeling the moving load analysis, we need that cross beams. But this time we need only one and add. And yeah, that's it. So let's close that. And for the boundaries also, let's quickly model a couple of them. So one of them will be end support. Add, and the other one will be temporary supports. Which we define 4 of them, 1 to 4, and add. It's created. So if you remember last session, we discussed about how the construction of these bridges are, and then how we have to, how we can use that, those temporary supports and different type of supports that we have. All right, for the load, let me define self weight first. This is something that we cannot skip from the structure. And then we have superimposed dead load. And then finally, we have the pre-tensioning. And for those, we have 1 to 30. I tell you why do we need to define 30 forces, because in this stage, we're going to apply only 1 pound force on each hanger. And then we can just do them, select them all and apply that 1 foot, but 1 pound. But for the purpose of this analysis, for this bridge, which has the hangers, we definitely need to define all these load, group loads, and then later on use them. I'll show you how exactly this will be helping us. All right, so we're done with the grouping. And let me go back and start the complete the modeling. So first of all, I want to assign the boundaries to the group. So for the boundary, if you remember, we're done with the node and element, we're done with the property, and now we go into the boundary. Define support. We can select the type of group of support, end support, and then D all means all degrees of freedom, translational degrees of freedom are constraint. So select all these nodes and all these nodes. By selecting this in this way, all the nodes in these two ends are selected and apply, so they are applied. Okay, and then it's time to define the static load cases. If I go to the load, under static load cases, we have to define some names for the static loads. The first one will be self-weight. The type is dead load and add. Then we have superimposed dead load. Please don't get confused with the static load cases name and the group names that we defined, because we are using the similar names because we're going to use them all, assign them all to the same structure, same element. So just don't get confused. These are the static load cases. Those were just the groups. And add. And as I said, the groups is required definitely for defining the construction stages. Pre-tensioning. So it's gonna be pre-tensioning 1, and I'm selecting the PS. This is the type. So we're gonna define 30 of them. So again, we need this because we're gonna come up with assign those unit loads to the structure, and then by help of software we're gonna find out what would be the best pretensioning force in each hangar, which give us the the straight structure geometry. So that's our final destination. And if you because this is, the first training for some of you, I don't use the text formatting, but it's very easy to create the text format, make these all in the Excel and then copy paste them here with help of MCT command shell. But I don't want to confuse you, so I think this one takes a little bit more time compared to that one, but I prefer to do it that way for the first day. All right, 10 more to go. Two 29, and then the last one. Okay, so we are done with the static load cases. Let me save it. Now we can start assigning the loads. So first of all, in the static load, we have to apply the self-weight. By clicking self-weight, you can select the load case, which is self-weight. This is we just defined, and then you can define the group for the self-weight. This will be important when we're doing the construction stages. So in the z-direction, -1, and just consider them whenever in the software, whenever you have capital letters like a capital Z, capital X, and Y, these are the global coordinate system. And when you are with the you see the lowercase X, Y, and Z, those are the locals. Now it will be global -1, add, and it's applied. Alright, so now I want to apply the superimposed dead load to this structure. Let me just ensure everything is done correctly. Okay, perfect. So the superimposed dead load will be applied on the girders. So let me inactivate this again. Go into the top view, and I wanna select all the longitudinal elements, and go with the beam element. Before that, I wanna set it up to the pound and inches. Okay, so my load will be -70 pounds per inch, and to select all the longitudinal element, I can just select them one by one. But Midas is giving you an option for filtering, and if you select the X, it means if you select entire the structure, only the elements which are in the X direction will be selected. So that's exactly what I'm looking for. So I select those, set up the load case name and also the load group and apply. So let's take a look at it. Display, and yeah, as you see, this is the distributed load applied on the all longitudinal girders on display. Alright, we're done with this. We have just one more step to apply that unit forces to the structure, to the hangers. Alright, so before that, let me assign those groups. If you go to the structure group, I want to assign the hangers to each group. So just selecting these, let me just turn off the filter with a none, and now by selecting each element, by the way, whatever I'm selecting here is two of them at both sides, because they are symmetric. I just have no problem to select them both together. Alright, and just drag and drop it here. You see that number of element increases to 2. Initially it was 0 because 0 element was assigned to this group. So let me just quickly do that for hanger 2, hanger 3, hanger 4, hanger 5, hanger 6. So still we have not assigned any load to them. We're just defining that these are just a basis of those. First we have to do that, and then we can switch to the assigning the loads, because in this way it will be more organized. Okay, eleven, twelve, thirteen, fourteen, and finally fifteen. So we're done with the one side. Let's go assign them to the negative angles. 1, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, All right, so 29, and then finally the last option, and 30. All right, as you see, all of them have two element assigned. And now we're done with this. Let's go and assign the forces to each group. All right, so to do that, I need to go to the load, and this time temperature and pre-stress, and then select the pretension load. So by pretension load, I have the list of all the load cases and also the load groups. All right, so what I do, I just bring in the second tree menu, and then start double-clicking on each hanger, and then select the hanger 1, pre-stressing 1, and group 1, and then applying the unit force. I set it up on the pound, because as I say, I want to just apply unit force to the each hanger, and then when we got those factors, I know that that will be the force, okay? Just let me just do it faster, because I want to cover as much as I can. Apply. Apply. So when we've done this, this will be the next step. Will be assigning the moving load. We can skip the moving load part, and then going to what is like more specific to this type of structure. And then if you guys have any question regarding this, we can discuss this more in detail. So as we discussed in the last session, finding the best hanger forces is a optimization problem, and today I'll show you how big it can be if you want to do the hand calculation, because when you go through the hand calculation, you're going to solve a pretty large matrix, and it can really be very time consuming. And sometimes doing a simple mistake, ruins everything. So that's very reliable to use a software like Midas that has already all this function in that implemented. Just for it's very easy and convenient to use that. And then also, if you have your hand calculation, you can also compare them, because not only software solve the problem for you and then show you what's the best. For example, hangers, and then you can also tune them, but also provide you those influence matrix, which you definitely need them when you're going to do the hand calculation. So generating those matrix also with hand, that's another issue with hand calculation, which because you have to consider a lot of constraints, and also depends on the number of the hangers, so it might increase exponentially. So you will see how Civil can help you in this way. All right, so I'm almost done. Five more to go, and then we can run the analysis. All right, 28. And by the way, if we didn't get chance to cover everything, We're going to share this tutorial and also model file with step-by-step modeling, and then you can practice it yourself. All right, so if I go to the Work tab, let me close this one, and if I go to the Load tab, we defined 30 pretensioning forces on each hanger. I mean, each hanger means each two hangers because they are symmetric. I just applied both of them, assigned both of them in one group. All right, so we are done with this. Now, next step will be moving load. I'm just skipping this point because I want to also show you how you can use the moving load tracer, which is a unique function to Midas Civil, and especially in this type of bridge, it can help you a lot. But let me show you more important functions. Now, I think we are ready to run the analysis. Let me save it and run the static analysis. All right, so this is the message window. You have to always check this because sometimes there are some issues coming up. There is no warning, no error message, so it means that the structure is run perfectly, and we got the results. So to see the results, you can go to the results, and for example, let's check the displacement. Displacement under the self weight, let's say DZ, and I want to check the legend. Or if you want to see the deformed shape, this will be also the deformed shape based on under the self weight. And these are the value you can see on the right side under this contour, and then you can compare. Now, what we can do, or you can also check them based on all the forces that we apply. For example, this will be this is exaggerated shape, so just showing you where the displacement happened. For example, when you have this press stressing in this element, this happens here. All right, now we want to find what is the best force here. What's the best hanger force for us to come up with the straight geometry in this structure. To do that, we go to the result, and then here under the cable control, we have two options. One is unknown load factor, another one is cable force tuning. So for the unknown load factor, if I click that, you know what, I just to save time, I open another model because here we have to define some constraints. So I opened this model, which is a final stage model. That's exactly the same geometry, the same material, everything is identical. And whatever I have here is just, I defined just a load combination, the load combination 1, which as you see, we are seeing all the pre-stressing force, self-weight, and superimposed dead load with the factor 1. So all of them have the same effect on the structure. Okay. And what we did, we go to the cable control and unknown load factor. So I already created an unknown load factor, but let me just show you how it looks like. We have two parts to set up. One is the constraint. Constraint means, for example, this is your structure, right? You want to ensure that the displacement of none of these nodes on the deck goes beyond a certain point. For example, here what I did, I set it up, let me show you, modify this. I set up the displacement of the node 131, which is right here in the middle span, in the Z direction, should not go beyond 0.75 inches, which is in a range that, I mean, depends on the design criteria, but as Gregor mentioned, the maximum tolerance for this construction of this bridge is 1 inch. So I just become more conservative and put 0.75 for upper bound and lower bound. Okay, so I assigned this and I defined 7 nodes, selected 7 nodes on each cross beams, and asked the software that my displacement doesn't go beyond certain point, or which is 0.75. But you can also add, for example, reactions. You can check, for example, the reaction on these nodes. or these supports do not go beyond certain point, or displacement, thrust forces, or beam forces. And also, if you want to just having a, this arrangement in a way that, for example, bending moment in this element is not going beyond this point, so we can say that. Then the second part is this forcing function. So this is my load cases, which I define them by unit load, unit pretensioning force, and I check them as an unknown. But the self-weight and superimposed dead load having the factor 1, because there is no way that we can you know, control the self-weight. The self-weight is self-weight. I cannot multiply it by any factor. And then superimposed dead load the same way, but we can change the pretensioning in the hangers. So this is why I selected that. Now I said that get unknown load factors, and then these values coming up for me. So these values, you see, pretension 1, 2, 3. So these are the values, actual values that I need to apply to the structure that the that my structure, this constraint that I defined, does not go beyond this 0.75 inches. Okay? So you see, for all of them, this value is given. And you remember we discussed about the influence matrix. So if you click on the influence matrix, depends on the number of the constraints that you have defined, and then the number of the pre-stressing or tendon that there are hangers that you have. This you know, create a large matrix for you when then you have to solve this matrix for coming up with that you know, to solve that, find the maximum for the forces, required forces in these elements. Anyway, just going back, now you got this force, and then now you can create and make a load combination. So we can call it practice 1 and then save it. So it's saved as a load combination, so we are done with this part. Now if you go to the load combination, you see that the practice 1 is created, and all the forces required for the hangers are assigned here. So now I know that I have to apply these forces on each hanger, because each one is related to one of the hangers, to come up with the almost zero deformation on the deck. Okay, so where do we use that? We use this option in construction stages, because when we go to the construction stage, we definitely should give the real pretensioning force in each hangers. Alright, so this is one part, but beside that, let's say some of the factors that you got here, you don't like them because some of them are pretty big, some of them are small, and then this is not in range of your area, so you cannot apply that for that force. Let me show you how to tune that forces. All right. So before that, let me just quickly define a group, which I'm going to use. So on high and go here. In a group, I want to just create a new group. Call it girder. All right, and then select these elements on the girder, exterior girder, and assign that. Alright, so this is just a structural group. There's nothing to do with that. If I go to the result again, and then under the cable control, we have cable force tuning. If I click the cable force tuning, let's see what we got here. Software gives me an option to tune my cables. How to do that? I'll show you. First of all, we have to select the load combination that we have. If I select the load combination LCB that we defined, everything is unit force because we defined it as a unit force. But we want to go with the practice 1. This is the force that the software gave us, right? This is the one that we got from the unknown load factor. Now somehow I want to see what is the effect of these pretensioning or forces in the hangers on my structure. So this is why I defined a group. Let me find it, girder. and I call it girder moment beam force my and add it. And I want to delete this one and select distance and modify. Alright, and close. So now if I go here, you see this is the bending moment. If I go with the keep feet, maybe makes more sense for you. So this is the bending moment happens on the structure based on the disc cable tuning, that the cable forces that we have. So let's say you are forced to limit the bending moment, or your section is in a way that it cannot handle more moment than a certain point. So let's say I'm going to limit this to negative 130, and then in the upper load I want to limit it to 165. Okay, and then show result. So this is my limit, alright, or let's just put it 160. Alright, so now I want to ensure that this bending moment based on these forces goes exactly in this range. So what can I do? You can just manually change them, or you can, you know, change them here, the number, or the easier way is just, you know, you can just drag it up and down, and you see whatever I do change here, it directly affects the structure, the bending moment. So if I increase this, so this goes down, that's perfect. Now I want to adjust this one, so it seems this one doesn't have any effect on this element. And maybe this one has some effect, because you know the structure is all working together. Therefore, when I'm changing this one, the moment here is also changing. All right. So by doing this tuning, you can just come up with the exactly the format that you want, or you want to just adjust them to become in the same range. So definitely, you can do that too. Okay. But another way is if you want to search that and do let the software does it automatically for you. So you can just select them, for example, say this and this element to be in this range. You can define the range and apply, and it provides you certain forces. Okay. So this is these are two functions that I want to share with you. These are pretty important and help a lot in the you know, when you're designing a structures which have cable, like a cable state, suspension bridges, definitely tight network, tight arch bridges. So these are cable based, and definitely these two functions can help you a lot in the you know, analysis and design. Just make your life so easier, and then you ensure that the results are correct. And for example, later on, you can just check the bending moment based on that bending moment, or you know, displacement or deformation based on the forces that we define. Unfortunately, we are running out of time, and I don't get chance to cover more material for more thing for you, because what I prepared, let me see if I have okay, I have the moving load run on this one. So what I want to show you is this unique feature of Midas Civil, which is moving load tracer. So I defined two lanes, you can just see them, two lanes on the structure, one is here, these are two lanes on the structure, and define two vehicles and define the moving load cases, which you know runs on the structure. Now if you go check the result, let's say going to the forces and then bending moments. Bending moment based on the moving load. Moving load maximum and apply. So this is the bending moment of, this is actually a envelope result, which is maximum bending moment of each element which experienced in a different load cases. Now let's say you are interested to know what is, what load arrangement or vehicle arrangement causes the maximum bending moment in this element. So let's check the number of element 80. Okay, this is one of our hangers, sorry, the arch elements. How to do that? For that one, software provides you a moving load tracer. So click on that and say bending moment and forces. Now I want to select the key element AD. Click on that. It appears here. And I want to check the bending moment under the moving load maximum and apply. Or the minimum force. Yeah. For example, the minimum or the maximum negative bending moment happens in that structure, that element is based on the this load arrangement. So when we have two vehicles side by side, so each of these showing one vehicle, so we have two vehicles side by side, and then we have distributed lane load on the structure, and this is causing me the maximum bending moment. So why this is important for you? See, here's the thing. When we getting the forces, the best pretension forces on the structure, we have to check the structure for moving load as well. So if you have a larger structure, you have like a wider structure, then you have so many lanes and then so many moving load trace, moving load cases. So it takes time to each time just run it. So for that one, by using this moving load tracer, you can just click on this option and then software save this moving load as a static load. Okay, save it as a static load for you, and what happens, you can just model this static load on your structure, and each time just, for example, change your section and then run it. You can you know, change the size of a structure and then run the analysis, but this time will be static analysis, which is way, way faster. For example, in a couple of seconds, in 2-3 seconds, you can get the result. Whatever, I mean, how big is your structure, doesn't matter. Yeah, this is one, and unfortunately I cannot cover the other part. I prepared another model for you. I just quickly show it to you to see what we got. So what I did is that I just used those forces as a pre-stressing force inside each hangar. So just to show you, if I go to the work tab and pre-stressing forces, if I right click and show the table, you see that these are the forces that I obtained from the first stage or the final stage model. Okay, whatever I got there, I applied to the structure. I just rearranged them in Excel and just copy paste them here. It's quick, it's very fast. And now my structure, each hangar has the real force in that. Okay, so what I did, let me just show you the steps. I also modeled 42 stages. So let's quickly review it together. So I cannot show you the modeling part because we don't have time, but just showing you the flow of this modeling. So deck one will be, this part will be activated. So let me just show the supports as well. All right. So I use the temporary support as you see in the middle part. In the Happy Hollow Park that Dr. Wallman presented, there they used the cable state false works because they didn't let them to use the support. But here, for the simplicity, I just use the simple support because what is important for us is not the those cable state structure, is but the structure itself. So this is why I model it this way. All right, so let's go quickly. Part four, so the tie is completed. Now we start constructing the arch. So these are the temporary elements we are using here just to create the structure. It's exactly the way that they used for Happy Hollow pedestrian bridge. So the hangar is also arch is also complete. Now is the time to apply the hangers. So as you see, the hangers are installed one by one from left. I hope you see them because they are pretty tiny element and you may not see them now. Alright, so we apply these one by one, and it goes all the way to the hanger 30. So still we didn't remove the temporary supports, because if we do that, the structure collapse, because there is nothing to keep them together. Now when we install these hangers, is the time to remove the temporary supports one by one, and those are gone. And this is my final stage. So this is what I see in the structure. Now what we can do here is that when you you remember the loads that we forces that we use in these hangers, here's the point. Those forces, those pretensioning forces, are the final final forces in the structure. But during the construction, definitely those forces are not enough, and this is what called lack of fit force. So we need additional forces to keep the structure together during the construction stages. So for doing that, I can show you the, for example, forces in these. If I go to the result, and let's say forces in the truss forces, and then the value. All right, if I go back to the hanger 1, oops, this is very large value. All right, now it makes more sense. So whatever we get here, if I go with the max, okay, now it's better. Hanger 3, so this is giving you the forces required for construction stages. So during the construction, in each stage, you need different forces. For example, I have to apply 63 kips in this stage on this. Next time when I apply the next hanger, this one. And then finally at the end, if you go all the way down, the forces comes to exactly the same forces that we defined, we found out in the first model, which was the final stage. Okay, so this is also another very important factor, and also you can get also the lack of fit force for the truss element. As you see, for each element we get the pretensioning force. This is the load that we applied on the structure, and we define that the each hanger should have, and this is the lack of fit force, which means it's required to be added to structure. So in addition to the pre-stressing force that we have to have even more forces on that to come up with the this much of force during the construction. But as you saw here in the model, this is the force that constructors definitely are interested in, and they want to know what is this force, because during the construction they definitely need such a forces. Okay, so I think I should conclude my presentation here. Sorry for not having enough time. This is a big model, and we need to consider so many things, and creating so many construction stages, groups, and those. So these are requirements, although they are simple, but takes time. So sorry for not being able to cover everything. We will be sharing this information with you, putting on our website, and you have access to download the model file and also the tutorial file. And if you guys have any questions, please feel free to call us, and I'll be so happy to answer all the questions one by one. This is my contact information. So you can send email directly to me, or you can send it to midasoft@midasuser.com. All right, thank you so much for attending the session, and have a great evening.